All right, let me begin by coming now to this first major division of Isaiah after the title, beginning in 1:2 and going through the end of chapter 35. And in the first 12 chapters, I just call it Introductory Oracles of Jerusalem's. That's going to be the focal point, but also Judah and even Israel. Chapter 9 into the first three verses of chapter 10 deal with the northern kingdom's judgment that's going to come in Isaiah's day by means of the Assyrians. Now, obviously, when Isaiah spoke it historically, that what he speaks, beginning in chapter 9, verse 8, the Lord sends a message against Jacob. It falls on Israel. That then all the way through, actually it's all the way through chapter 10, verse 4, that in Israel still existed. And the Assyrians were the ones that God was going to use. And then beginning in chapter 10, verse 5, he then speaks his oracle of judgment against the Assyrians. So as we go through, we see that and these obviously come from earlier and even to later on in Isaiah's ministry. We cannot date except for what takes place in chapter 6 and chapter 7. That very, very clearly is going to be dated based upon the narratives that we have there. But outside of that, these are just the beginnings, and we usually assume that he has brought these chapters together in a thematic way, and we'll then trace that that through here in just a second. Then chapters 13, and I'm going to take it all the way to chapter 27, deal with his oracles of the nation's judgment and restoration. Significantly, in chapters 13 and 14, he will speak about Babylon. And of course, we realize during Isaiah's day, Babylon was not a major player. In fact, it was under the governance, under the authority for most of Isaiah's time, with the under the Assyrians. It was only for a time. Right around the same time, Hezekiah rebelled against Babylon. Same thing in around 706 to about 702 B.C. The Babylonians sought to rebel as well, and of course faced the same kind of wrath of the Assyrians as did Jerusalem. The difference was, of course, Jerusalem was able to maintain after that its semi-independence, and Babylon from 700 B.C. on was not able to do that. It was not able to gain its independence later till 726 B.C. But then when we come to Isaiah chapter 13, 14, the thrust is against Babylon. It's only in verses 24 to 27 of chapter 14 that Isaiah, almost as an addendum, also gives some judgment against the Assyrians as well. And of course, you got to realize he's given a major message against the Assyrians anyway in the latter part of chapter 10. So Babylon becomes more of his focus in chapters 13 and 14 as opposed to Assyria. But we'll take a look at that first thing next week. Then it comes together in chapters 28 to 35. We have here a collection of woes, woes being oracles of judgment. These are the woes. These are the judgments. These are the curses. These are the hardships, the burdens that are going to come upon the people because of their sin. And we're going to see that one of the major sins pointed out in chapters 28 to 31 in particular, is the folly of trusting the nations instead of Yahweh. And particularly, think then back to chapters 13 to 27. If God's going to judge the nations, the nations of Isaiah's day, chapters 13 to 23, and ultimately all nations, chapters 24, and then particularly the judgment of salvation of Israel, chapter 25 to 27. If he's going to bring his judgment upon everyone upon the earth, why is the Judeans of his own day, the rulers of his own day, turning and trusting the nations who can't be trusted and ultimately going to be judged by God when you can trust Yahweh? So you can start to see a little bit of the folly of trusting the nations instead of trusting Yahweh when we get to that latter section there. Now underneath, and what we want to take a look at, particularly in these last moments today, are these introductory oracles that make up the first 12 chapters. Isaiah begins his book in chapter 1 with a lawsuit. Basically, he hauls verbally the Judeans of his day, the city of Jerusalem of his day, and brings them before the bar of God's justice and finds them guilty. Yahweh has a case against his people. That's why we begin, "Listen, O heavens, hear, O earth," in verse 2. Here is Yahweh speaking. And this echoes Deuteronomy chapter 32, that when there is a covenant breach, the witnesses are the heavens and the earth. And Yahweh presents his case before the covenant's adjudicators, the case he has against his people. And his case basically, in the latter part of verse 2 and verse 3, is the rebellion of his people. The result, verse 4, is that they are a sinful nation, weighed down with iniquity, seed of evildoers, sons who act corruptly. They have abandoned Yahweh, despised the Holy One of Israel, turned away from him, that is Yahweh. All right, so Yahweh's people, it's unnatural. Even animals know their owners. Animals know, you know, the one who takes care of them. Israel doesn't. Therefore, verses 5 through 9. The whole nation is sick from top to bottom. Verses 5 and 6, 7 through 9, the land has suffered great desolation. And in fact, whether this is prophetic or whether he is speaking about a present reality, which again would seem, if it's a present reality, 701 B.C., but he could be looking forward to that, is the fact that the land basically has become desolate, and Jerusalem is like a head that is left because of the occupation that has taken place. And in fact, verse 9, unless the Lord of hosts had left us a few for survivors, we would be like Sodom, we would be like Gomorrah. We would be completely destroyed because of our sin. For God has maintained a remnant even in Isaiah's day, or will maintain a remnant even in Isaiah's day, to remind them that God's judgment is not total and not complete. Well, with Israel being guilty, with the people being guilty, the Israelites, In verses 10 through 20, we now have an appeal. The case, you're guilty. The appeal, recognize your sin, repent, and be restored, or continue your obedience and be devoured by the sword. So it's in 1:10, hear the word of the Lord. You rulers of Sodom, give ear to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. So, not quite like Sodom and Gomorrah as far as the judgment reaped, but as far as the heart, you're just like Sodom and Gomorrah. You're rebels against Yahweh. They seek to appease their rebellion, verses 11 through 15, through their religious activities. And God says, I hate them. Your religious activities are not done in faith toward me. I take no pleasure in them. Guilty people bringing their sacrifices to me does not remove their guilt. Rather, wash yourself, verse 16, make yourselves clean. Implied, you're unclean. Remove the evil of your deeds from my sight, cease to do evil. Right? Your repentance will be seen in both your washing and your living up to my standards. Learn to do good, seek goodness, reprove the ruthless, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. If this takes place, though your sins were as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Verse 19, if you consent and obey, you'll eat the best of the land. If not, you'll be devoured by the sword. By the way, hear the echoes of Deuteronomy 28 in verses 19 and 20. Obey, you will be blessed. Consent, you'll eat the best of the land. Refuse, you'll be devoured by the sword. So eating plenty, devoured by the sword, right? Leviticus 26, Deuteronomy 28. Now at this point, God has a case against his people. They're guilty. He gives them the opportunity to repent in return and be restored to covenant blessing. If not, if they continue in the path, they will be devoured. Will be further pictured in chapter 5. But then he turns in verses 21 to 31 to speak of Jerusalem. He's given the tenor of the people as a whole. How is this reflected in Jerusalem in particular? The faithful city has become a harlot. What does that mean? She was full of justice. Righteousness was lost in her, but now murderous. Probably the faithful city was during the time of David, who sought to follow the Lord's ways, apply Torah to his people. That's when she was full of justice. Now we're getting ready for chapter 7. The Davidic house of Isaiah's day is less than it should have been, particularly during the time of Ahaz. He was a evil king, and so Jerusalem's situation is reflected. Yet we've already seen in verses 24 to 26, God is going to have the last word. He's going to deal with his opponents who created and made Jerusalem this way. And the end result will be judges and councils, leaders like before, and once again, a city of righteousness, a faithful city. Notice how verse 21 is reversed at the end of verse 26. 27 to 31 then looks at that reality of Zion's redemption, and once again, those who hear, all right, are Are you going to be sinners, transgressors, rebels who are going to suffer judgments when Zion's redeemed? Or will you be those who do turn to the Lord and participate in his redemption in the future? So there it is. I mean, to a certain extent, in chapter 1, Isaiah's message has already been given in summary. This is the Israelites' problem as a people. This is how it's manifested itself in the city of Jerusalem. God presents his case. He appeals for them to repent and basically says, I'm going to work out my plan and purpose, and what the ultimate consequences are to you, my people, all depends upon the decision you make. Are you going to throw your lot with me? Or are you going to be my enemy and pay the consequence? Then chapter 2 leads into the next subsection, which goes through the end of chapter 4. Has its own subheading. Now, the word which Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Beginning verses 2 through 4, at the end of the days, when Jerusalem redeemed Jerusalem, chapter 1, the place of righteousness, the place of justice, will be high and lifted up, and where all the nations will come to learn of Yahweh's his ways, his Torah, to hear his judgments, the result will be that there will be peace. He ends up there in chapter 4, verses 2 through 6. He begins in chapter 2. Okay, this is what Jerusalem will be in the future. And 4, 2 through 6, in that day the branch of the Lord will be beautiful and glorious, the fruit of the earth. Some take the branch here to be the land. But also from 2 Samuel 23:5, the branch of the Lord is a term for the Davidic king. And Jerusalem, again, it will be seen as the place of worship of Yahweh, restored worship of Yahweh. And talks about Mount Zion and the refuge that is there that will give protection, salvation, deliverance, and where the proper worship of the Lord will take place. Well, in between these two statements of what God is going to do for Jerusalem in the future. 2:5, come house of Jacob, let us walk in the light of Yahweh. Let's live in light of that future reality. Why that appeal? For you have abandoned your people, the house of Jacob, because they're filled with the influence from the east. Soothsayers like the Philistines strike bargains with the children of the foreigners. Their land has been filled with silver and gold, etc., etc. And so the land, verse 8, has also been filled with idols. Instead of being a light to the nations, as Jerusalem will be in the future. The present reality is Jerusalem is just like all the rest of the nations. Instead of being a light to the nations, the darkness of the nations has come into Jerusalem. Therefore, verses 12 to 22, the Lord of hosts will have a day of reckoning. God is going to bring the pride of man. And by the way, the emphasis here against the cedars of Lebanon, the oaks of Bashan, verse 13, is against the ships of Tarshish, etc., is he is going to bring the nations, he's going to bring the idolatrous nations into judgment. Chapter 3, 1 through 4, 1, and Jerusalem is not going to escape. You threw your lot with the Gentiles. When God judges the Gentiles, Jerusalem will be judged as well. So Jerusalem, which way do you want? Are you going to walk in the light of the Lord? Or are you going to do it the nation's way and suffer the nation's consequences? Now, obviously, the visions of Jerusalem in the future, and the Messiah is going to come, and the bounty of the land and the true worship and deliverance is going to take place on Zion chapter 4, is at the end of the days. So what about in the immediate time period? I mean, Isaiah has looked ahead to the far distant future. So what can Jerusalem anticipate in the near future? Chapter 5. They are God's beloved vineyard. Verses 1 to 7. And now, verse 3, O inhabitants of Jerusalem, men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. Though God was a faithful farmer, vineyard grower, Jerusalem again has proven to be abominable, sinful, unrighteous. Verses 8 to 12, therefore God's judgment is going to come upon them. Woe to those who had house to house. Woe to those, verse 11, who rise early to pursue strong drink. Verse 13 through 17, my people go into exile for their lack of knowledge. So their unrighteousness brings about these actions which will bring God's sure curse, his sure consequences, judgment, and that judgment is going to be exile. Further in verses 18 to 23, more woes. Woe to those who drag iniquity with cords of falsehood, those who call good evil and evil good. 18, 20. 21, those wise in their own eyes. Verse 22, those who are heroes in strong drink. Those who lie, those who call evil good, wise heroes of drink. Whew. Sounds like somebody watched television this weekend. Getting ready for Super Bowl Sunday. There's Isaiah. Now, this was Super Bowl Sunday in Jerusalem, and it wasn't going to be a pretty picture. All right, you're going to sin in this way. Therefore, verses 24 to 30. Again, he talks about exile, but now he speaks about the fact of how God is going to bring an adversary. He's going to bring a nation against them. Verse 26, he will also lift up a standard to the nations afar off, and he will listen for it from the ends of the earth. And behold, it will come with speed swiftly. No one is weary, no one slumbers. His arrows are sharp. And interesting, he's going to pick up that image again of whistling and not sleeping nor stumbling, coming with swift speed. And in chapter 8, that's going to be the Assyrians. He's talking about the Assyrian invasions culminating in 701 BC. So there's going to be an attack by a nation. Of course, ultimately, there will be exile. And of course, even under the Assyrians, certain of the Judeans, though not the city of Jerusalem, were taken into captivity. So the coming judgment and restoration of Jerusalem, and now Yahweh's ultimate exile of his people. So against this backdrop, Isaiah is called. Now, some have said, this seems to be out of chronological sequence. It is. But it's in thematic sequence. This is why Isaiah is called. He says, I am a man of unclean lips among a people of unclean lips. How unclean were they? Well, chapter 1, purify yourself. Cleanse your hands. Do good. Return to the Lord. There are people far away from the Lord that will suffer the consequences in the near term, chapter 5, and in the far distant future, chapter 3, before God brings his ultimate salvation to Jerusalem. It's in that backdrop, it's in that context, Isaiah's call to his prophetic ministry. We've already taken a look at chapter 6. How bad was it? Chapter 7. The house of David itself now explicitly referred to during the time of Ahaz as being against Yahweh and under his judgment. And we'll come back to that to deal with Isaiah 7:14. But chapter 7:1 through 9:7 is about how God is going to bring judgment near and far against the house of David. And then ultimately, chapter 9, bring restoration. Then in chapter 9, verse 8, we have the message against the northern kingdom. Like I said, through chapter 10, verse 4, assuming that at this point the northern kingdom still exists, so it was given historically before 722 BC. Categorizes her sins and the fact of how God is going to bring judgment against them. 10:4, nothing remains but to crouch among the captives or fall among the slain. In spite of all this, his anger does not turn back. His hand is still stretched out. And even with Israel's ultimate judgment, God is not through bringing his judgment upon his people because they still refuse to give up their evil. Now again, all of this is, as I said, the northern kingdom. But then Isaiah turns in 10:5, woe to Assyria, woe to the instrument that God is going to use to judge the northern kingdom. Can turn in verse 24, therefore thus says the Lord, O my people who dwell in Zion, turns to Jerusalem, do not fear the Assyrian who strikes you with a rod and lifts a staff against you, the way Egypt did. For in a little while my indignation against you will be spent, my anger will be directed to their destruction. And so God's pronouncing of judgment upon the Assyrians, the rod of his anger against the northern kingdom, take heart from this judgment, you who live in Jerusalem, because the Assyrian will not prevail against you. Ultimately, my indignation against you will be spent, and I'll direct it against the Assyrians. And that deliverance from the Assyrians anticipates chapters 11 and 12. The greater deliverance is going to come from out of Jesse. The Davidic house is finally going to be restored through this coming shoot. And it's going to be in that day when this king comes to exercise his kingly authority that the events of the second Exodus are going to take place. Chapters 11 and then 12 will lead to the people's giving thanks. Because of the excellent things he has done, let this be known throughout all of the earth. 12:6, cry aloud and shout for joy, O inhabitant of Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. So what he is sharing is, near term for the northern kingdom is going to be exile. Near term for the southern kingdom is going to be the Assyrian coming in, invading the land. But God ultimately is going to deal with the Assyrians in the land, and then ultimately they're going to be lopped off. They won't remain, but what will remain is the promise to David. And when that promise comes to pass, then the totality of Israel, all the people, no matter where they're scattered, are going to be brought back to the land and experience the salvation of Yahweh. Now, within this section, the first 12 chapters, is nestled one of the major interpretive issues of the Old Testament. So major, it gets its own discussion in the World and the Word. Rooker, speaks in a number of paragraphs of how to understand Isaiah 7:14. And I would say if the unity of Isaiah is the major interpretive issue outside the book, that one of the two major interpretive issues in the book is, who is the virgin? The second great interpretive issue in the book next week, who's the servant? Particularly of chapter 53. But who is the virgin? And of course, we can only answer that when we determine, well, who is the child? Who's the son? All right, let's look a little more precisely at chapter 7. Here's one of the few places where Isaiah tells us exactly. This came about in the days of Ahaz. That Rezin, the king of Syria, or Rezin, the king of the Arameans, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up to Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not conquer it. The Arameans and the Israelites attacked during the days of Ahaz. This is right around 735 BC. When it was reported to the house of David, saying, Syria had camped in Ephraim, his heart and the hearts of his people shook as the trees of the forest shake with the wind. Even though they went up and could not conquer it, when the report of the action and what was determined, the plan, was given to the house of David, that is to Ahaz, it shook him to his core. Now, Ahaz is an evil king. We already know that from 2 Kings chapter 16. And so here is Ahaz shaking in his sandals. And so the Lord sends Isaiah to try to give him encouragement. Go meet Ahaz, you and your son Sherajashub, a remnant shall return. It's interesting, his first child got the salvation name. The second child got the judgment name. But right now he's got, the remnant will return. So here is his son. So here's Isaiah to give a word of encouragement with his son, the remnant shall return, and say to him, take care, verse 4, and be calm. Have no fear. Do not be faint-hearted because of these two stubs of smoldering firebrands on account of the fierce anger of Rezin and the son of Remaliah. Notice They have a plan. But the Lord says, verse 7, it shall not stand. Their plan was to remove Ahaz and put their own puppet upon the throne in Jerusalem. Now, Ahaz, you might be a scoundrel, but you are the son of David. And so what this proposal by these two wayward kings, Aram and Israel, what they're trying to do is they're trying to destroy the Davidic dynasty. They're trying to destroy the Davidic house. They're trying to remove the Davidic house. So Ahaz, it's not because of your own personal, you know, piety. You have none. But you happen to be a son of David, therefore their plot will not stand. Trust me. Hey, I'm a son of David. Thank you, Lord. I needed that. The problem is Ahaz is not a believer, and Yahweh knows he's not going to believe. There's going to be no confidence. There's going to be no resting in God's word. And verse 9, if you will not believe, you shall surely not last. And then God does something very compassionate. Then the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign for yourself from the Lord your God. Make it deep as Sheol or high as heaven. Yeah, the grave to the heavens. I mean, and anything in between. You know, merism. Of course, and don't make it easy. I mean, make it hard. In other words, ask for a sign that God's word, that the house of David is not going to be removed, is sure. And Ahaz turns spiritual in verse 12. I will not ask nor will I test the Lord. Now it's true, you shouldn't. You should not put the Lord to a test, except when the Lord says, ask for me a sign. And make it miraculous, make it big, make it huge. Make it a sign that only Yahweh can do. And now Ahaz says, I will not test the Lord, because he doesn't want to believe the Lord's word. Then he said, Isaiah speaking for Yahweh, listen now, O house of David. It's too slight a thing for you all to try the patience of men. Now understand at this point, he has been dealing with Ahaz as an individual. It's all singular. You. Now the you is no longer singular, it's plural. It's too slight a thing for y'all to try the patience of men, that you all will try the patience of God as well. Therefore, the Lord himself will give y'all a sign. Ahaz, you refuse to ask for a sign that God will not let this plot against the house of David stand. I'm going to give you now the sign that's going to guarantee a son of David on the throne that cannot be removed. This is not to Ahaz individually. This is to the house of David that he represents at that point. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you all a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel. He, that is, this child, this son, will eat curds and honey at the time he knows enough to refuse evil and choose good. An idiom, verse 15, for moral discrimination. So in other words, when this child born to this virgin reaches the age of moral discrimination, at a time he will eat curds and honey. It will be a time when the land will be under the same kind of hardship because of foreign oppression as is coming upon Israel during Ahaz's time. He will live, and before the boy, that boy will know enough to refuse evil and choose good. The land whose two kings you, Ahaz, dread will be forsaken. Now, at this point, the sign is a miraculous sign. Yahweh himself says, I'm gonna make this the kind of a sign only I can bring to pass. And it's going to be, now, Alma, the Hebrew term, what does it mean here? It means young girl. But every other time it's used in the Old Testament, the other four or five occasions, it's always a young girl of marriageable age, i.e. one who is of a point of being able to be married but is not. And so the implication is this young lady, this young girl, is a virgin. So I would say a young lady of marriageable age who is not yet married and is a virgin, here's a sign, will be with child, bear a son, and that son will have the name God with us. And by the time the son comes to moral discrimination, the two kings that Ahaz fears will be long gone. For the Lord will bring on you, your people, your father's house, such days as never come since the day that Ephraim separated from Judah, the king of Assyria. All right, comes back now to the near term. You know, the king of Assyria is going to come. He's going to bring desolation to the land. If you go back to 2 Kings chapter 16, Ahaz tried to avert this by buying off and becoming a vassal to Assyria. But, of course, only that didn't stop anything ultimately, even though this plot was stopped. He stopped the plot by getting the Assyrians to invade Damascus. So much for not trusting God, but trusting in your own devices. But in the end, that was going to be disastrous. All that got was the Assyrian. One step closer, you know, Damascus, you know, 732 B.C., 722 B.C., you know, takes over the northern kingdom. What's next? Ultimately, the Assyrian is going to invade the land, which is exactly what Isaiah predicted. And the rest of this and into chapter 8 deals with that near term judgment that's going to come in Ahaz's day through the Assyrians. But let's get back to, well, who is this child? And you can read, because Rooker takes position C. It's a child that was born to a woman in Isaiah's day because it has to be assigned to Ahaz. Now, what I just share with you about how to understand the passage, it doesn't have to be a sign directly to Ahaz. It is a sign to the house of David, of which Ahaz was the representative hearing at that point. The direct sign, actually, to Ahaz, and the son who's going to be born with the sign for Ahaz, chapter 8, verses 1 to 4, is going to be Isaiah's second son, Mahashala Heshbash, swift as the beauty, swift as the prey. Remember that from chapter 5. Who is the one here? I would go along with Young and Motir. Smith leans this way. It is a direct statement concerning the ultimate son who's going to guarantee the throne of David, who's going to be born of the virgin in the future. That is chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. That son, that child, is going to be God with us, the eternal Father, wonderful counselor, mighty God, Prince of Peace. And to be orthodox, you have to be B or C. You can't just say a child of Ahaz, Isaiah's day only, because we have Matthew in the Bible that says with the birth of, well, actually the conception and birth of Jesus to Mary, Isaiah chapter 7, 14 was brought to fulfillment. So you either got, you know, a type here that is fulfilled, or you got double fulfillment, but obviously Matthew makes it very, very clear that this is a passage which in some way was pointing to Jesus Christ. And I think the best way to understand it is directly. It is, to use the term, exclusively messianic. There's only one son in chapter 7. There's only one child. There's only one woman who's going to bring forth that child, and that's looking to Mary and ultimately the Messiah, Jesus, who is God's guarantee that the Davidic house is never going to be destroyed. No plan against David's rule can ever stand. And Messiah is the guarantee of that. Now the question often comes, well, how was that a sign for Ahaz? And my answer was, well, immediately it wasn't. Now, it was a sign to Ahaz. Was Ahaz alive when Messiah was born? No. In the day this takes place, in the day that the sun comes forth, in the day that he gets the moral discrimination. Yeah. These two kings you fear are going to be long gone. Well, Ahaz, so are you. Not, we now know historically. Isaiah didn't say that. That was, historically we know that to be true. But I would say this, and I have to go over it because I take a different position than Rooker. I see it as exclusively messianic. And our time is gone. So, if you want to discuss it any further, I'll stay after the class, or you can come early next week. But the key is seeing that there's almost an aside in verses 13 through 15 that is speaking to a different audience than 16 and following. He comes back to Ahaz at that point.